Hi, and welcome to 8-Track Flashback. I'm David Cassidy, and for the next 30 minutes, we're going to strap on our silver platforms and ease on down the road to the golden age of funk, the music that was so bad that it was good. Funk reigned as the dominant black music of the 70s, a nastier, harder, and more danceable hybrid of soul. Funk was party music, and getting funky quickly became the national pastime. Among funk's disciples were War, who got their start in 1969, backing up then-football great Deacon Jones. Jones kept his day job, and shortly thereafter, War began playing with former Animal, Eric Burdon, a collaboration that resulted in the hit Spill the Wine. In 1971, Burdon split, and War hit the road, bringing with them an infectious brew of Latin, R&B, and jazz that reflected their multicultural background. Here's War from 1975 with their tribute to Cruisin' Lowrider. Our next funk band came together as music students at Alabama's renowned Tuskegee Institute. After playing around town as the Mystics, they reinvented themselves as the Commodores, a name they came up with by flipping through a dictionary and randomly putting their finger down. Anyway, the Commodores became one of the biggest funk acts of the 70s, selling over 25 million records worldwide. Led by singer Lionel Richie, who, of course, went on to have a less funky but a very successful solo career, the Commodores had several hit singles, including this one from 1977. Here's the Commodores with the lip-smacking Brick House. Turn with a groundbreaking track from Stevie Wonder, so stick around.
are having an 8-Track Flashback.
Hi, I'm David Cassidy, and welcome back to 8-Track Flashback's look at the golden age of funk. By 1973, the year he recorded his top 10 pop hit, Living for the City, Stevie Wonder was already a seasoned veteran of the music business. The former child prodigy's career went through many changes in the 70s. Perhaps the biggest was his sound.
Stevie was a genius. He made so many contributions to music. He was a visionary. He wrote lyrics of all sorts that directly addressed issues. A prince of a person when it comes to humanity.
From the landmark album, Inner Visions, here's Stevie Wonder and Living for the City. It's the 70s, and the collars were wide, the shoes were sky high, and the afros were even higher. And the cinematic exploits of Shaft, Slaughter, and Foxy Brown were the hippest thing going. Blaxploitation films were made by black directors, writers, and actors, and featured storylines aimed primarily at black audiences. Filled with action and adventure, and of course, the funkiest music, blaxploitation films made stars out of Pam Grier and Richard Roundtree and helped define a funky urban brand of cool.
What's up on the screen?
The movies during the 70s, the so-called blaxploitation period, it reflected times a lot. When a person who had constantly been seen in the light of subservience was on the screen as a hero, of course you're gonna get the attention of the black viewing audience. I don't care if you were a pimp. If you had a position of power, yes.
Grow wings, Superfly, grow wings.
Problems, baby?
Yeah, I got a couple of them. I was born black, and I was born poor.
You dig?
Right on, brother.
Don't jive me.
Who does she think she is?
Well, that's my sister, baby. And she's a whole lot of woman.
Wild Cherry hailed from Cleveland, Ohio, and got their name from a box of cough drops. Like many bands, Wild Cherry harbored dreams of rock and roll stardom, but 1976 was the year of disco. Wild Cherry found themselves booked into dance clubs, packed with customers who had boogie fever and wanted to shake their groove things. So one night in Pittsburgh, Wild Cherry took to the stage only to be greeted with a prophetic cry, "Play that funky music, white boy." You can guess the rest. The result was a slice of electrified funk that went all the way to number one and made Wild Cherry one of the few white funk acts, proving that while white men may not be able to jump, they can get down. Here's Wild Cherry and their platinum-selling smash, "Play That Funky Music, White Boy."
Yes, I did.
is so much better. I'm funking out in every way, but I'll never lose that feeling. No, I won't. Of how I learned my lesson that day. When they were dancing and singing and moving to the grooving, and just when it hit me, somebody turned around and started playing that funky music, white boy. Play that funky music, right. Play that funky music, white boy. Lay down the boogie and play that funky music till you die.
When we return, we'll check out an anthem from one of funk's founding fathers, so stick around.
Archives, great moments in music history from television's past.
She didn't spit the Beatles.
VH1 Archives, premiering May 29th at 9.
Hi, welcome back to 8-Track Flashback's Journey to the Golden Age of Funk. I'm David Cassidy, and if funk had a royal pecking order, then George Clinton was both king and clown prince. Along with Bootsy Collins and Bernie Worrell, Clinton was the mad puppeteer behind Parliament and Funkadelic, arguably two of funk's finest and most influential acts. Parliament Funkadelic's concerts were full-blown funk operas, lasting over 3 hours and revolving around a group of extraterrestrials returning to Earth in search of the funk experience. From their 1976 classic Mothership Connection, here's Parliament with the funk national anthem, Tear the Roof Off. Wraps up 8-Track Flashback's look back at the golden age of funk. As George Clinton preached, free your posterior and your mind will follow. advice we can all live by, can't we? After all, life seemed a little bit cooler when America was one nation under a groove. Till we get down with our bad selves again, I'm David Cassidy, and I'm out of here.